Welcome back, everyone, to the Geeks, Geezers, and Googleization Show, the home of Googleization Nation, where we talk with HR and business thought leaders about the crazy shift going on all around us and explore the disruptive convergence of technology, business, and people. Here are your hosts, Ira Wolfe and Jason Cochran.
Hey, welcome back, everyone, to another episode of Geeks, Geezers, and Googleization. I'm Ira Wolfe. Thanks for being part of Googleization Nation.
And I'm Jason Cochran. If you think this is just another podcast, think again. We're the voice of the most important conversations on the future of work that's confronting business leaders and people today. And our goal is to bring you ways to reimagine tomorrow as we explore the ever-changing convergence of business, technology, and people.
This episode of Geeks, Geezers, and Googleization is sponsored by our partner, Y Institute, your personal and professional GPS for a meaningful life and purpose. You'll hear more about the Y Institute and their Y operating system in during the show. On today's episode, we're going to take you on a bit of a commercial workspace odyssey. So buckle up, folks. We have Bryan Berthold from Cushman & Wakeman. They are a leading global real estate service firm. Bryan will be joining us in just a few minutes to talk about the current and future state of where and how people work. The conversation isn't going to be what you think it is, because most conversations and discussions today seem to focus on remote versus hybrid versus bringing people back to the office. And all those conversations are centered on the location of work. But those conversations leave out the big elephant in the room, flexibility. And flexibility means a lot of different things to a lot of different people. And when it comes to the future of commercial workspace, flexibility is about as clear as mud. So what does this mean for future office space? More empty offices, vacant buildings? What does it mean for downtown businesses and those that real estate? And what about new workspace designs? Say that three times fast. New workspace designs. You're going to want to stay tuned, which leads me right into today's perfect labor storm segment. This is where on each episode we focus on a disruptive, surprising, and worrisome trend that we believe you should know. Here's today's perfect labor storm. Let me share a survey that popped up just minutes before we went on the air. It was released by Quantum Workplace. They surveyed over 1 million workers, and they found that only 10% of the respondents equated flexibility with location, such as the power to work. There are six possible flexible work arrangements that workers told Quantum they'd prefer. Five of them don't require a home office or a corporate office. Flexibility of time, days worked, scheduled shifts, tasks performed, and who to work with. Now, I don't know if we're going to get into that part, but I'm sure of when will offices be occupied, what days will they be occupied, what type of shifts will be available. This is going to be important not only for the businesses, but also for the surrounding support businesses. This defines our workspace odyssey. And executives and business owners are got to be asking, how does this impact the space where people will work, and what needs to happen to ensure increased productivity and engagement? So we're going to be talking with Bryan about Cushman & Wakeman. They just released a report on commercial real estate, and there's over 1 billion square feet of office space, which will be vacant by 2030 in the U.S. alone. That's nearly 20% of the total workspace. And according to the same report, the concerns aren't limited to just how much space may be vacant. It's also that 25% of that space will become obsolete. And according to Morgan Stanley, the valuations of all that workspace, that office and retail properties, could fall as much as 40%.
Yeah, and Ira, Cushman and Wakefield, they're leading the way with a lot of the research and surveys on what does the future of our physical workspaces look like. And this is really important because it sounds like the clock is ticking on this next domino falling and the chain reaction of events that are surrounding the future of work. When I first met Bryan just a couple months ago and we had a conversation around this, He totally enlightened me. I know this is going to come as a shock, but I am not a commercial real estate expert. Bryan is. And so having him, along with all of the resources and supports from Cushman and Wakefield, bringing those insights today is going to be really helpful. And, you know, it got me to thinking, just this last weekend, I started watching the Back to the Future movies with my two older sons for the very first time. And I totally forgot that the opening scene for the first Back to the Future movie, the opening scene is a Rube Goldberg machine that Doc Emmett Brown had at his house. When Marty shows up, the machine is designed to ultimately open a can of wet dog food and dump it in his dog's bowl. And the dog's name, cleverly, is named Einstein. For those who maybe haven't heard of the term Rube Goldberg machine, I can guarantee that you've seen one before. The term is for things that are popular. You see them on social media, where something like starting a stack of dominoes that then hits a bowling ball that goes down a ramp. You get the picture. All of those things happen, and it turns a simple task into an overly complicated chain of reactions that it takes in order for that simple task to be done. So that's the opening scene in Back to the Future. Now, part of the reason that it's so fascinating to watch these Rube Goldberg machines is because they're taking something simple like opening and dispensing dog food in a bowl, and they're making it way too complex. And doesn't it kind of feel like that's where we're kind of what we're doing right now with the future of work? To a certain extent, it feels like we're maybe making things a little bit harder on ourselves at times by trying to hold on to the old ways of doing things. In this case, maybe mandating people back to the office simply because it's how things were done in the past. Fresh thinking means that we may need to adjust local tax policy, commercial real estate strategy investment, and even consider redesigning or repurposing old workspaces to revitalize those areas, particularly downtown areas. And so luckily for you, our listeners today, we've got an expert in this space who's going to help us make sense of it all and help us prepare for these looming changes that are ahead for how we think about our workspaces. So without further ado, let's give a warm Googleization Nation welcome to today's guest from Cushman and Wakefield, Bryan Berthold.
Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. It's an honor to have you with us today. And like we said, this is going to be kind of groundbreaking territory for us on the show to really dig in on what all these changes mean. But before we get to the meat of that, let's learn a little bit about you to begin with. How did you get an interest in this area? And tell us a little bit of what you do at Cushman and Wakefield and how you are helping lead the way and how we redesign and rethink our physical workspaces.
Sure. Thanks. I only have an hour, right?
That's right.
So my background, I'm a licensed architect, the old fashioned kind of drew buildings and what have you. And I joined Cushman about 8 years ago, more focused on workplace strategy. My background was design strategy and really creating a lot of bricks and mortar solutions for clients. But one thing that I realized early in my career and in working, I've worked through numerous banks prior to coming here, is that in the real estate world, we focus on the bricks and mortar. We focus on the desk, the conference room, the tech. And there's not a lot of training and understanding of how we actually impact the people that we serve and we're producing these solutions for. In fact, as an architect, I designed many schools, and I realized after the fact, I never interviewed a teacher or student while I was doing it. You know, shame on me. But as I was working in various banks, I realized that HR was doing their things. We were in real estate. Tech was doing theirs. Maybe they were talking to the business. Seldom did they talk CFO language. And I just took a step back and said, I'd like to know. I'm an analyst as well. I'd like to know how we're actually impacting the people. So I actually want to turn all these things into KPIs, data, and insight, and replace the subjectivity that often business leaders have of what they think is going on by actually getting into the hearts, minds, and souls of our people. So that was something I was actually doing off the side of my desk when I first got here, and that has morph into the creation of a product we call Experience per Square Foot, where we can actually use employee sentiment to understand, hey, what's going on with design or technology, or the services and amenities or the value of a location. And for the first time, actually measure the experience of people, not just all the stuff we give them. And that's turned into a role, believe it or not, I started in April of 2020, focused on a global workplace experience role, leading that for Cushman. So my focus is understanding human behavior to solve business problems for clients, and the study in aggregate, what's going on here? What have we learned through the pandemic? And replace that subjectivity with real, true data and insight.
I love that, Bryan. And of course, Ira and I, we love talking about human behavior too. And so we're going to be excited to dig into this report. I'm curious, just off the top here, were there any things that came out in the Cushman and Wakefield report recently in terms of demographic differences or things that maybe surprised you of how the typical American employee thinks about the workspace?
Well, it's interesting. In fact, we've been reporting in aggregate on the global results, and we just stepped back to say, hey, maybe are there regional nuances? So let's take attendance, for example, and I thought this was interesting that here in the US, the Americas in general, 53% of people still want to work remotely. And our definition is, I want to come in less than one day a week. And then when we moved over to Europe, we found 43% of those people want to be hybrid. That's the majority. They want to come in a day or two a week. And then when I went over to Asia Pac and looked at the data there, 63% want to come in three or more days a week. And what's interesting is the differences. So if I start to unpack what's going on in Asia, we have like a third of the people said there are better workplace setups in the office. There's better tech in the office. It's easier to focus in the office. That's actually the conversely true for the other regions. They're saying my setup's better at home. I can focus more at home. So we're finding, hey, they have the same drivers, but the drivers are actually for leaning in more to the office. So I think as we start to unpack this and learn more, we're still seeing a predominance of people wanting to work remote in the U.S. Now, that's driven, majority of the reason is 70% of people are worried about the commute. That's the biggest pain in the butt. We don't see it at that high level in the other regions. And they find it easier to focus. They like the casual environment. And chances are they have good tech and setups at home. So The commute keeps rising to the top, but the reasons for the office, what's missing, it's all about community and connection. So what they do want to come in for is to socialize, to collaborate, and it's not just the work. That's, I think, one of the dilemmas we've seen in our data is in a virtual world, we just talk about the stuff we do, usually with, sorry, I'm late, and I got to jump to another call. Well, in the office, you have that pre-meeting, that post-meeting, how was your weekend, socializing, overhearing conversations, that kind of serendipity that can happen, and building your relationships. We tend to start narrowing in into the silo of the group we work in, and don't really get exposure to our leaders, to other ways to get mentored and learn. So these are things that we're saying, they want to come in for those reasons. But yeah, here in the Americas, overcoming the commute is probably the biggest hurdle.
So, hey, Bryan, I had a couple questions from things you just said. So, on where people work, the geographic impact of where people work. So it sort of reminds me of going back 2 years, maybe 3 years, when we first went into lockdown and everybody went home. It seemed that people that didn't live in a major city that didn't have that commute were, once they got their IT, their laptops, their networks, and they found a closet or a table or a desk or a sofa to work on, they became more comfortable. But people in the city, especially like Manhattan, Los Angeles, they wanted to go back to the office because they often they shared a 700 square foot apartment with three people, or their family, or a dog, and so that when you mentioned what was going on in Asia, that reminded me there, because they certainly have much smaller living quarters than we do here. So in the U.S., were you able to dig in and break that down? Did it seem that more metropolitan areas wanted to go back to the office, but more suburban rural areas were okay?
Actually, we found it almost the reverse, because the commuting was a lot easier in the suburbs. You know, that wasn't an issue. Whereas people didn't feel safe. A lot of people relied on public transportation to get in. They now, in downtown, you got to pay for parking. There's data out there that says, hey, we saved about 8% of our paycheck not having to travel in the cities. So that's something that you got used to. Now having to pay for all that and pay for dry cleaning and parking and all of that is something, a hurdle to overcome. And in the suburbs, we saw them picking up and starting to come back at a faster pace. So I think the cities and urban areas have to overcome that public transportation and the higher cost of the commute.
Yeah, interesting. And I want to go back and really dig into what you said. I love this concept, experience per square foot.
Jason
and I talk about this all the time. I've got 5 speaking engagements coming up. Everyone is focused on employee experience and how to improve that. But I love this new metric, and I'll definitely be including it. So can you tell us a little bit more about that? I mean, how do you measure employee or the experience per square foot?
Yeah, and the per square foot, I would say, is a reference to say this is about your work environment. What differentiates us from an employee engagement survey, let's say, because if you've ever taken one, most employee engagement surveys may have one question on your work environment. Usually it's a safety question or something like that. But when we look, most of the time they're looking at your company, your manager, the job you do, your comp structure, benefits, your colleagues, but they don't get into the work environment. So we decided we want to study that at the same rigor that a lot of these, Gallup surveys, Glint surveys do with HR engagement. And what we set on a course to do is there were a lot of surveys. We study all kinds of surveys that are out there. And most do ask you about your workplace tech services, all of that. But to me, I'll use scientific terminology, that's the stuff you use in engagement. There was actually no measure on your experience. So through our research, we've got PhD data scientists and people that we've engaged with HR to kind of create our measure of the experience. And it's broken into 5 components. So picture a 2x2 grid, work-life balance on your y-axis, you as a person, individual, and working with others on the x-axis. So on this work band across the top, well, we created measures on your ability to focus and feel productive when you're trying to get your work done, your head's down. And then as a team, are we productive when we need to work together and collaborate? Most surveys we found just asked about work. We then actually had a band around life. So are you energized throughout your day? This is your well-being, which we started this survey back in 2017, but COVID really heightened the importance of that measure. And then with a group, are you bonding with your colleagues? Do you have a sense of community? Is this a greater sum of the individual parts? And then a 5th measure that we put in the middle is, are we continuously learning and developing? So each of those gets scored and averaged into your experience per square foot score. And what makes this survey a delight is we still measure all those things, your attributes on design, tech, and what have you. But then we run these statistical analysis and regressions to say what actually drives those 5 experience measures. And it's always different. Every market's different, every client, every industry. And I think what's fascinating is we did an analysis that said there's about 40 categories of things on the stuff side. But usually only 8 to 10 are driving the experience. So you're spending money on 40 things. I'll tell you the 8 or 10 that you should spend your money on. And then on average, half of those are doing great and the other half are struggling. Could be a missing amenity, could be something that's subpar. And this is where CFOs and the people that own the purse strings lean in, because they realize, you mean there's only 4 or 5 things to super invest in? Yes. And it's great, because now we take that subjectivity of my people don't want a gym or whatever, and replace it with what is actually driving people to come to the office, or why are people staying at home? What are those obstacles? And let's actually learn about what's going on here.
And so, Bryan, I got to ask the natural follow-up question. What are those 4 to 5 things that actually matter?
Oh, it's different for every client. You know, Jason, it wasn't going to be. If it were that easy,
right,
I'd just figure it out, button it up, and you just pay me for the answer. And once it hits the internet, I'm done.
Right. I love that. No cookie cutter answers. Very specific for each client.
Like, we find it's nuances. Like, we have 9 different demographics. So we'll cut by the business, by... Are you an individual contributor or an executive? Your tenure at the company, what generation are you, your location? So all of these things, we'll even get into gender and ethnicity, which is really a big important of our DEI kind of component. And there are different drivers for each one of those segments. So you may find headquarters location in LA will have a completely different driver set than, say, a back office building in Singapore. And it should. You may have operational people, you may have admin people, you may have a sales team. Well, their needs are all unique. So that's why I always say, ignore what you read. Those can be directional, but your company is unique. You as a person's unique, but your team makeup, that's really what matters. I always say coming back to the office is a team-based decision. Some of you want to come in all the time, some never do. But you as a group know when we need to be together, when it's okay to stay back.
The parallels between some of this, Jason, I don't know if you were thinking the same thing, but one of our partners is Avanti. And a cybersecurity company about 2 years ago, they started to talk about digital employee experience. And again, it was beyond just does the technology work? It was, how do they feel about it? And, what was the support level when they needed help? What did that look like? And even double and triple sign-ins and double factor authentications. You know, was that a good experience or a bad experience? And when everybody went remote, it's like, oh, we got to lock down our systems. But then it was impossible for people to actually log in. It had nothing to do with working remote or productivity. So they started to look at the digital experience, the employee experience. And what they found is that 1 out of every 4 employees was willing to quit because of a bad digital experience, a digital employee experience. Have you been able to find any correlations with retention or recruitment that related to the experience per square foot?
It's our correlations lie in what drives people to come back and what are the obstacles. So one of the biggest challenges is we're all very effective from one chair at home. All my tech works, my laptop, I can do my heads down, I can get on a call. The minute I get into an office, I have to move around. And I remember that taped on the wall webcam, that phone. And, it was standard that meetings took 10 minutes to start because we all were trying to connect and get the slide presentation up. Now we notice we just click the Zoom call or the Teams call and we're on, we're live. And what I think the biggest challenge we're finding now on the tech side is how do we make that experience of coming back, not going back in time to what I remember as being suboptimal. So that's really where tech has to step up and create a great experience, be easier to use, easier to find, and adding new dimensions that we don't need at home, like finding people. I was talking to a reservation technology company. So here are one of the things of, hey, what's changed? well, do we need desk reservations? Are we going to be desk sharing? Yeah, but you got to think differently. I use a restaurant analogy because I'm coming in to be with my team. So I want to reserve a table for four, like I'm at a restaurant. You wouldn't go and make a restaurant reservation with four individuals and hope that you all pick the same booth. No, I actually want four seats together, and I want the reservation system to do that. Otherwise, I come in and you're on a different floor, and now I got to tell Ira and Jason I booked the conference room just so we could talk. No, that's where tech has to step up and realize, what's the experience? Are we easy to use? And I would say the majority of people are going to start feeling like guests in their own building. So this is why hospitality and the experience has risen, is I don't have a routine anymore. If I'm only coming in a day or two and you say it's desk sharing or reserve a seat, I'm like getting re-familiar. It's like visiting, I talk about buildings being more community centers where you're bringing people together. Well, if you go to a community, an event, a conference, you don't know your way around, but they're hospitality minded. There's a concierge, they help you figure things out. So you need to remove all those pain points so that I can be productive. I will say the number one thing that people look for are productivity factors when they come in. So I'm being asked, hey, what are the right amenities? What's the right food? What should we feed people? Is free parking? All these carrots on a stick. You know, they're good for one time. Free bagels on Tuesday will get me there, but not on Wednesday. What I found is, and it's interesting, like we've had a few clients in a row where you better have two monitors on the desk. That's a deal breaker. Oh, the tech in the conference room, the video hookup better work with Teams and allow us to take outside people and the people in the room. I better have an ergonomic chair. People want to be productive as a group, and when they do heads down work, when they come in, the rest of it is tertiary stuff that's nice to have, but it's not going to, people realize I'm very effective at home. I say, I can do my job description at home, so why would I come in?
Yeah, and to go with that, Bryan, I recently saw some studies that said on average, what the typical American is saving in time is around 70 minutes per day of drive time. Is what the typical American was driving to get to and back from work. But the other interesting thing with that was the question came up of, okay, can we find out what are they doing with that extra 70 minutes? Turns out the majority of it they're using toward work. So they're actually putting it back in, reinvesting it in the work that they're doing. And you would hope that, you know, the more we all kind of get used to this, the more we have better supports in place, that this will help improve efficiencies and productivity for people as they're working from home. And I'm going to send it back over to you, Bryan, because I can tell you've got something you want to share there related to that.
there's a lot I can unpack with that one. So I'll give you some headline data points, and then I'll match that to the points that you're making. So overall, you know, we've got these common myths that we hear. And I'll kind of work here to dispel them. So the first is, we see mandates are on the rise. So let's get all our people in. Let's try to do that. And Ira, you were talking about flexibility. Okay, this is huge. When we measure our experience per square foot, workplace experience insight, we find that there's a 27%. You guys still there?
You're still here.
Okay. We're good. I lost your visual. We find a 27% drop in the workplace experience when you try to dictate what location people should work from. So if you say, I need you in the office Tuesdays and Wednesdays, that experience drops 27%. It drops another 28% if you actually tell them when they have to work. So you mentioned time, days, shift, all of that stuff. Yeah. If you start to tell people when they have to work and where they have to work, it's an easy button for leaders to think that'll get attendance improved. But the negative impacts on my experience, and we're seeing about a 25% drop in employee engagement when you do the same. So huge risk there. But what we have found with productivity over time is it never moved. Productivity has pretty much stayed constant. But if you ask people, they say it's about 75% of people saying they're productive. Two-thirds will tell you they're working more hours. So to your point, Jason, what are they doing with that extra time? It's a work-life balance problem that when we're at home, we tend to work more. We don't know when to turn it off, which is interesting. Pre-COVID, I used to have leaders when we tried to build telecommuting programs saying, well, how do I know they're working when they're home? And it's like, no, you got to worry they're working too much. And the data is just proving its point. And the repercussions on this, and this is probably my most worrisome, you know, what do I worry the most about is our well-being. So just to pick this apart, 73% of people in 2019 said they had a good sense of well-being. This is mental health, physical health. It went to 55% in 2020, 46% in 21, and last year, 39% of people report having a good sense of well-being. So the extra hours, not being together, not having that FaceTime, not learning, not doing all those things outside of just the routines, it's taking its toll on people. And at the end of the day, I think that sense of caring, you mentioned caring, Jason. I think managers need to do a better job just checking in on their people. Don't call on a project call to say, hey, how's it going? You have everything you need. Because I don't think people have really had a natural place to vent or just showcase their own concerns and get their heads in a better place. But 39% and still eroding is probably the number one concern leaders and companies should be worried about. That's the burnout factor.
I'm on mute. You're speaking our language there, Bryan. We've been trying to get that message out for a long time, and I appreciate all the data and the research that you're providing, which also cues this up for the next segment. We're going to take a short break here. For our next segment, we'd like to come back and get your perspective on what, not only what should companies be doing, but what's that future space look like? We talked about flexibility. So if companies do get it right and they do allow people to have flexible work, not just hybrid, but flexible, they can pick and choose which days they come in. They can come in and they have that positive experience. What does the, you know, what's the future of commercial real estate look like in that environment? So we're going to take a short break. You're listening to Geeks, Geezers, and Googleization. We're here with Bryan Berthold from Cushman and Wakefield, and you're going to want to stay tuned. We'll be right back.
For most of us, change is freaking terrifying. And unfortunately, there's no app to adapt. That might change in the not so distant future, but for now, we're on our own. That means we can either accept our default future or reimagine our tomorrow. For those of you who choose default, good luck. Just remember, there's no pause button for change. You can't turn back the clock, and there's no get out of jail free card in this age of perpetual uncertainty. Like it or not, change will happen all around us. And that change is not becoming just more disruptive and frequent, but volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous, or VUCA. Fortunately, you can make change work for you and turn it into your personal and competitive advantage. Reimagine your future to one in which you're living with purpose, you're happy, and you're growing, thriving, and flourishing. If you're ready to rewrite your next life chapter and regain control of your destiny, in this never normal world, your journey starts here. Contact the leader in adaptability and making change work for you, your team, and your organization. Ira S. Wolfe, adaptability.expert.
There's a certain kind of coach who believes what we believe, who leads people to greatness, who gets people unstuck, who unlocks all of your passion. A coach who helps people discover what drives them to tap into their superpowers. then knowing your why is the first step to untapped potential, to focus, to breakthroughs. A coach who's looking for a better way. Are you that coach?
Hey, welcome back, everyone, to Geeks, Geezers, and Googleization. We are talking about the commercial space odyssey, what's happening to commercial spaces. And we've had a fascinating conversation. We're waiting for Bryan Berthold from Cushman & Wakeman, Wakefield, to come back. And Jason, the experience per square foot just blows me away. I think we were looking for different types of metrics over time. And again, that's a new one to me. It seems pretty obvious, though, and one that might get the attention of CFOs and CEOs and basically business owners and executives when they're trying to measure what can you do for recruitment and retention.
No doubt. And Kate Lister comes to mind, a friend of ours of the show, a Global Workplace Analytics. We're going to have to get this over to her also, because I think there's a lot of overlapping conversations and trying to help senior level leaders understand what they're going to do with physical space and how to make use of it. I mean, I was just blown away by what Bryan just shared before we took the break there on combined. If you take the freedom of when to work and where to work, if people feel like they don't have that choice, their experience drops 56% just with those two things. And so as he was sharing all of those things with the experience per square foot, the one word that was sticking out to me is autonomy, freedom. Like, ultimately, that's what people now in the future of work are looking for when they're working and they're looking for an employer, is they want that flexibility and freedom of when to work and where to work. So I was just totally blown away by that. But Bryan, before we went to the break, welcome back. Ira teed up, you know, another part of the conversation that we want to get into also, and that is we kind of have this $1.5 trillion of commercial real estate loan debt that's coming due by 2025. That's way more than anything I understand about commercial real estate, but how concerned should we be about that? And ultimately, what should leaders be thinking about as those rents are coming due and thinking about the workspace that they need?
Oh, it's the million-dollar question, or I guess the trillion-dollar question, as you put it. I think the challenge we have, we've never been through such a transformational time, because chances are anyone's work environment pre-COVID, the way it's been sitting there, is not meeting the needs of tomorrow. So first, let's talk about what does tomorrow look like, and then how do we overlay a portfolio on top of that? So there's kind of this trifecta of what's happening. Businesses have changed. So some companies, they're shifting their labor around. So they've enabled virtual work. They're thinking now of a workplace ecosystem, which is the office, third places, could be flex space, or remote working, working from home. So where does it make sense that maybe there's certain types of jobs that can stay at home? And if so, let's find high quality labor in a lower cost market than maybe where we've been in the past. So labor is moving around. And then you look at the portfolio, where should those locations be that can ease the pressure on commutes, be in a desirable neighborhood? We've got this whole work-life balance equation of people preferring to have a walkable life where they can live and work in the same zip code. And then lastly, what's happening inside the building? And that's where we're trying to help clients better understand what's the transformation with the inside of, and how do we need to adapt. So the one way of thinking about it is the primary drivers of what are those reasons people would come in. I mentioned to socialize and to collaborate, but we're also finding people that come into the office 3 days or more a week have a higher well-being score. They're getting more time off from work, better work-life balance. And I think it's because, you know, they close that lid on the laptop, they decompress on a commute, they're more present at home, and they're not just continuing to work longer hours from their home. And so they're better work-life balance, access to better tools and more robust tools. Again, we'll talk about the digital technology and assuming that those investments are being made. In fact, the companies that are investing in better tech and more cutting edge tech actually are finding a 56% improvement on their overall experience, have two times more sense of belonging with the company and feel more connected to the company culture. So there's a lot of advantage to investing in the tech side of things. And then lastly, we haven't talked about it, but feeling part of something, feeling connected to your company culture. So how does the work environment do that? But this is a physical manifestation of your culture. What is interesting is about 3/4 of people said they were connected to their company culture pre-pandemic. Right now, that's only at 52%. So only half of the people in our virtual way of working feel connected. So we know the office has value to kind of be that cultural haven. Now, we mentioned choice and flexibility. Now, check this out. So for that 52%, if you have the choice of when I come in and are trusted by your management and you make those choices, 70% of those people feel connected to company culture. If you live in a mandated environment, it drops to 36. And we hear culture eats strategy for breakfast. So that's something to, it's even actually at its highest point, 77% of people coming in 3 days or more a week by choice are the most connected. So as a result, these buildings are about community and connection. So what we're seeing is a paradigm shift of what used to be 2/3 of the space for seats, dedicated heads down work, and then breakout spaces for conference rooms. No, this is a conference center now. So now it's 2/3 about meeting spaces, brainstorming rooms, war rooms, learning environments. This is where we come together and learn the next and innovate together or sell. This is what's going to be predominant. And think about it. If you go to a conference center, is your first question, hey, where's my desk? What's that look like? No, I need a touchdown spot. I need a place where I may need to do or make a call. So that's not the reason I came in. If I only came in to do that, I can stay at home. So that's a major change in our designs. Not all buildings are adept at being able to adapt to that kind of new experience. And I'll say there's a people side to this equation too. And this is a big concern I have. So back in the old days, when I got hired and my job description existed in the office, think about it, as a manager, supervisor, leader, I didn't have to tell you why you had to come in. You came in. Now, leaders are in an uncomfortable and unusual situation where they actually have to create a sense of purpose for the building. And an agenda. Hey, I don't go to a conference if I don't know who the keynote is, what the breakout sessions, and who else is going. In fact, if you don't plan with your team, we did this research with George Washington University, where if you're working from home and only coming in 2 days a week, and you just do it randomly, you have less than a 30% chance of bumping into the people you want to meet. So you actually have to schedule and be planful. It's like going to dinner again. You wouldn't make a reservation and hope the other family member's coming. Leaders creating the events. Hey, the CFO's here, or we're going to brainstorm on this, or our technology guy's going to teach you on our new ways of using video conferencing. Whatever it is, there has to be these breakout sessions in kind of a itinerary for coming in. People will then pick and choose the events and plan their days. Hey, let's go to this learning event in the morning. We'll meet as a team later in the day. So these are new ways of thinking about the space. So that's basically describing it's going to be a different environment. And when we say obsolescence is the new opportunity, there's a third or so of the buildings that can meet this shift. They've got the tech in place. They're in a good neighborhood. They're easy to commute to. They're going to meet this new demand. And then there's going to be a middle layer where, you know what, there's investments that need to be made. And now it becomes a return on investment exercise to see if the payback's there. If I got to invest X millions, do I get out of it? And then there's those buildings that no matter what you do, put it lipstick on the pig, it's not ever going to be this group plus people come and convene. Now, that doesn't mean it's a loser and it's gone. That just means it needs to be repurposed into something that it's more suited for. Now, we all know that, hey, we're not probably going to need as much office space. That just means these buildings that are not in this new kind of vocabulary are going to be repurposed for other needs. And that's where clients have to dig in to figure out which ones of my buildings can provide the new environment. We like to use our experience per square foot data and say, hey, score the experience of every building. Then you know the value of that building and the cog in your ways of working. Identical space may have totally different experiences because of who works there, how long it takes them to get there, and the types of workers that you have in that space. So I said a lot there.
No, that was brilliant stuff, Bryan. As you were describing that, it made me think kind of the shift we've had in terms of human capital, of how we go about measuring value creation for people and people that are creating value in the marketplace. And it sounds like at Cushman and Wakefield, you all are blazing the trail of helping leaders understand what's the value of the workspaces in terms of what it's providing to the community, for the internal stakeholders and things like that. And I'm glad that you're doing this because as we talked about in the perfect labor storm, there's a whole bunch of change we're going through right now and we're going to go through over the next few years. The insights and research you all are doing is going to be tremendously helpful for these leaders in understanding whether they need a workspace, how to redesign it or reimagine it, or whether to repurpose it so that we can make sure that we try to mitigate the effects of the $1.5 trillion of real loan debt that's going to be coming by 2025. But I'm going to kick it back over to Ira real quick. I can't believe we're already coming up near the end of the show. He's got a question that we always like to end with before we get to our final couple segments.
Hey, Bryan, and I just got to tell you, there's some episodes that I just can't wait to re-listen to because it was like, I know I missed something and I would be like, I was writing something down and forgot it. And yours is definitely one of them. And we can go on forever. I'm still stuck on that experience per square foot. but here's the question. We threw a lot of questions at you. What's something that you hoped we would have asked you, but that we didn't?
Oh, well, I think I started to fill in the gaps if there was something that made me lean into other topics. I'll answer that by just saying, I think the biggest key thing is we used to implement and execute things around real estate, and then we measured the, as I said, I had that passion for wanting to know how this impacted people. And I think what's unique here is we're starting with the impacts on people first. So what's the existing space? What's working from home? How does that impact people? And now let's design the real estate solution around that. And that's my true hope, is that this isn't just a satisfaction, feel good, happy, survey that we do. We're trying to open up and get leaders to understand in the hearts, minds, and souls of their people what's working, what's not, what's going to make you love our company, what's going to make you thrive as a person. And I think that's something that just drives me. That's my passion. And I remove the subjectivity. We're in a day and age with ChatGPT and AI to censor data that it's too expensive to guess and get real estate wrong. In fact, I had a CEO at a bank tell me, I gave him free food, I paid for their parking, I gave him free lunch, and they're still not coming back. Okay, I would never do this with my business, guessing, and they're using our survey to say, tell me what's really going on. And that's what I really am hoping that people spend more time doing.
Brilliant, Bryan. There's so many incredible nuggets here of wisdom that you shared with our audience. And so before we let you go, we're just going to segue into our last couple segments here as we wrap things up. And the first one is called Hopes and Fears. And so I would love to hear from you here. What are your hopes for the future and your fears for the future?
Well, as I said, my hope is that we lead hard into caring for the people. We're seeing health crisis and burnout, and that we really focus that the work can be the number one contributor to poor health, that we really take a hard focus and start with the experience of our workforce, their engagement, be more hospitality minded and caring for them, and creating work environments that do that. That's my hope. And I would say my fear is we just go old school and go back to get your butt back at the office and design things that look pretty in a photograph but aren't functional and are actually hurting us. Because we got an opportunity here. I think you spend less money and you're much more efficient. You know what to do with those leases and your portfolio if you're in tune with your people.
And for all of the CEOs and CFOs who are listening to this episode and watching it, yes, this is Bryan Berthold of Cushman and Wakefield. They are in the commercial real estate business, and he's telling you it is bad practice to be mandating people to return to the office. And so we're thankful that as a company that they're leading the vision and helping us all adapt and grow and rethink about this in the ways that we should. And so with that, Bryan, we're going to go into our last segment here, which is the lightning round. Just a few questions. We're going to ask you to get to know you a little bit more. You're not going to get struck by lightning, I promise. These are going to be softball questions just to help our audience get to know you a little bit more on a personal level. So let's start with this one. What's a favorite band or a favorite song of yours?
My daughter and I, she's a hockey player through college, but You Get What You Give by the New Radicals. That's our pump-up song that always gets our spirits, no matter what. We're pumped up to take on the next challenge.
I love it. And how about this one? If you could pick any superpower, what would you choose?
You know, it's interesting. I had somebody, I thought I'm strategic and they do all this. And they said, hey, what's your superpower? And they're like, you're Spider-Man. And I'm like, what in the world? I'm Spider-Man? They're like, you have all these connections. You just make everything come together. And it's what I enjoy doing. It's just building networks, teams, getting people that don't necessarily work. Like half my clients are heads of HR and I'm in a real estate company. I really like that. Just bringing the world together, kind of a superpower to get us to all row together to solve these things.
I love that. That's the first time the Spidey Sense piece, the networking, has been picked on the show. And just a couple more real quick, Bryan. If there's one person in the history of the world that you could spend the day with, who would it be?
Oh, wow. It's interesting. I always went with, like Albert Einstein to learn the science. I've been going more with psychologists. And there's any number of them to just understand human behavior, because it was a big gap in the way I was brought up and learned real estate. So whether it's Freud or whoever you want to choose, learning from all of them, it's opened up many new ways of thinking for me.
I love it. And you're right in my wheelhouse. I definitely would love to spend the day with Freud. No telling what would happen with that. And then last one here, Bryan, let me see here. I had it written down here. Oh, it's the biggest pet peeve. What would be your biggest pet peeve that you see people do that just gets underneath your skin?
Well, being focused on human behavior, to me, it takes listening and understanding. My biggest pet peeve I know why. I think that people that don't listen and think they know the answer. I have lots of stories. I constantly am surprised with my survey. Just one to kind of showcase, we had in LinkedIn over in Asia and Hong Kong, they asked us, hey, can you add a question if they like the showers? Sure, we'll add in. But what was surprising to me is they liked the showers, but we found all the people using them, their focus scores went down, their concentrated work. And we're like, what? I actually talked to a neuroscientist and he said, what temperature is the water? And I'm like, oh. And sure enough, we found the water was too hot. So everyone thinks that they know the answer why the focus scores may be down. No, actually, it's the temperature in your shower room. You know, be open to listening and hearing and look at the data. Let that drive your thinking, too. There's a lot we can learn from all of this, and it's never what you think.
So well put. And all I can think about too now is how popular all of these ice bath therapies are. Every time I hop on LinkedIn or Twitter or Instagram, it seems like every other picture is someone hopping into a tub of ice. So I'm going to have to figure out what that's all about too. But Bryan, we can't thank you enough for being with us today. Again, Bryan Berthold of Cushman and Wakefield. You can learn more about the company and the work that they're doing, helping us think about the future of workspaces, by going to CushmanandWakefield.com. And then also we've included in the comments a URL that you can go to learn more about their experience per square foot survey. Bryan, thanks again for being with us today. And we'll definitely have to have you on again in the future for a part two.
Thanks for having me. I enjoyed it.
Thank you, Bryan. Appreciate it very much. We'll be in touch.
You bet.
Ari, you're absolutely right that this was just one of those episodes where we could have kept going on and on. I wrote a book down just like you did. What were some of the things that stood out to you?
Well, again, I've said it a couple times already. Experience per square foot is kind of a whole new model, but I love the idea Bryan said something about the building needs to have a sense of purpose. We talk about purpose all the time. The building needs to have a sense of purpose. Fits right into what we talk about with why and discover your why. And what it builds is connections. I mean, your whole foundation is the four principles of connection. How do you build that connection without that? And we overlook this, but I this was the one thing that hit home. We can talk about collaboration, going back to work, having better teamwork, you know, the digital experience and all those things. But Bryan mentioned this, lack of serendipity is why people need to come back to work. But the problem is companies have structured work so much that they actually took some of that serendipity away. You know, so it's how do you bring that back? How do you bring that culture back? So again, so many things interweaved. But I think looking at the future of commercial space or an office space, could be small, big, of a conference model, you know, that I never went to a conference and said, where's my desk?
Right. That's such a good point. Yeah. I mean, just like you, there were so many things today. The two I'll just share real briefly that are going to stick with me. He mentioned only 52% of people feel connected to the organization. And obviously you referenced it. You know, we talk about the four principles of connection, you know, our proprietary framework for how you build purposeful and meaningful cultures. You have to build connections that help connect people with themselves, with others, their role, and also with the organization, which includes the physical workspace. And they're doing tremendous work in that area. And we need more organizations to become aware of this. And we'll certainly be doing our part to share this with our community, because this is the direction we got to focus, is helping to understand how we design workspaces that fulfill that promise of creating purposeful and meaningful work cultures. And then the other one was just in terms of how many buildings right now are really prepared for the future of work. And by future of work, we're talking just like this decade, like by 2030, it sounds like he was saying roughly 1/3 of buildings kind of have the infrastructure to be able to do that. And the rest of them, there's going to be a third that needs some tweaks or upgrades. And there's going to be a third really that's like obsolete, where it's just going to have to be completely gutted, redesigned, and things like that. And so thankfully, you know, we have Cushman and Wakefield out there that's helped leading the way to make database decisions around that, to help executives understand how to utilize that workspace. But can't express our gratitude enough for Bryan joining us today and dropping all of those insights. But until next time, Googleization Nation, if you haven't liked and subscribed to the podcast or left us a review, we'd appreciate it if you did. And until next time, I'm Jason Cochran signing off.
And I'm Ira Wolfe. Special thanks to Y Institute for partnering with us and sponsoring the episode. Thank you for being part of Googleization Nation. And until next time, don't let the shift hit your plans.